access, better market access. It's very logical also. Market access means giving importers better access to our market. Market access is about giving importers better access to our market. How can we give importers better access to our markets? When we reduce tariff and non-tariff barriers. Here we are talking of lower tariff and non-tariff barriers in agriculture. Okay, so it was said that agricultural tariffs and NTBs were also there till 95. The idea is to reduce it so that there can be free trade. I hope you are following that. It has actually reduced a lot. Even India has reduced it quite significantly over these 20 years or slightly more. Then comes export subsidies, which we have done again. We have seen that export subsidies are an example of unfair trade practice. So this rule is simply telling that remove any export subsidy if it is there. Okay. Although again, India doesn't need to worry a lot about this, because we were hardly giving any export subsidy at any point of time. Most of the export subsidies historically in agriculture have been given by Europe, European Union, which is, European Union is one member of WTO, so we don't talk about separate. Okay, so European Union has been the major export subsidy provider, and they have reduced it after 95. Although they still give significant amount of export subsidy. Now comes domestic subsidy. Now, first of all, it is a little surprising claim that why WTO is even talking about domestic subsidy. After all, WTO has to deal with free trade. Why is it talking of domestic subsidies? Because even domestic subsidies can sometimes impact trade. Okay, let's take a simple example. How can domestic subsidies also impact trade? Not always, but sometimes it can. Suppose that there is a farmer in India. Okay, there is a farmer in India who can produce, say, 10 kilograms of rice with 100 rupees of cost. Without subsidy. There is no subsidy so far. So without subsidy, a farmer in India can produce, say, 10 kg of some rice with 100 rupees. Now, if he is given subsidy with the same 100 rupees, as you can guess very well, he will be able to produce more, let's say 15 kg of rice. Are you following? Now comes, till now also there is no problem. We will say, what has WTO to do with that? We are giving subsidy to our farmers. The problem comes now. Suppose that a farmer in Bangladesh, okay, with same 100 rupees of cost, can produce 12 kilograms of same variety of rice without subsidy. Now, can you see, WTO will have a problem. Why? WTO will have a problem because without subsidy, who is more competitive? The Bangladeshi farmer. Without subsidy, the Bangladeshi farmer here is more competitive. With the same amount, he can produce more. So in the ideal free trade, what should have happened? Bangladesh should have exported that rice to India. They have comparative advantage. So in ideal case, Bangladesh should have exported that rice to India, but actually this will not happen. And who is the culprit? Subsidy. Once subsidy is given to the Indian farmer, he beats the Bangladeshi farmer in competition. Are you getting the point? I know this is oversimplistic example, but this is just to tell you that even domestic subsidies can impact trade. In this example, the domestic subsidy given to Indian farmer is hurting the Bangladeshi farmer in exporting rice. Okay, these examples keep on changing. More realistically, in place of Bangladesh, you can keep India. In place of India, you can keep US or European Union. That is what we are debating in WTO a lot. Okay, I'm coming to that one by one. But WTO tells that all domestic subsidies should not be reduced. The rules are different depending upon the type of subsidies. For that purpose, domestic subsidies themselves are divided into three parts, okay, which are often called the boxes of subsidies also. The first one is green box subsidies, then comes blue box subsidies, and the third one is amber box subsidies. I will not discuss blue box in much detail because in any case it is not so important. Mainly we will be thinking of green box and amber box. Let's begin with green box. Green box subsidies are non-trade distorting subsidies according to WTO. Green box subsidies are the subsidies which are non-trade distorting, or according to WTO, they do not impact trade. I'm adding the phrase according to WTO because it has also been debated. We are coming to that. Okay, what are some examples of green box subsidies? Many are there, and I'm sure you have heard of these things. Any subsidy given on, say, agriculture investment, okay, like irrigation related, irrigation infrastructure, not irrigation in terms of power subsidy. Or we have agricultural research and development. So subsidy given on agricultural investment, research and development. You might have heard of agricultural extension, where the farmers are demonstrated about some new technology. Okay, that is all green box example. You can read more on that. One more example I would like to quote here. Decoupled payments. These are very common payments in Europe. Okay, which also come under green box. Decoupled payments means the payments to farmers. The payments made to farmers by the government, irrespective of their production. So no matter how much is the production by that farmer, if they are given a payment, we call it decoupled. Decoupled literally means not linked to production. Decoupled, which means not coupled, not linked to production. Okay, so all these payments are called green box. Coincidentally, by now we have some examples of decoupled payments in India also. Remember the direct income benefits which we were talking of, Raitu Bandhu, etc. These are also examples of decoupled payments. I have told you earlier that WTO generally favors direct subsidy. Okay, coming to blue box. Although I will be brief, as I told you, just a quick definition and I will move on. Blue box subsidies means subsidies given under production limiting programs. Okay, there are some programs which are called production limiting programs. Subsidies given under these programs are kept in blue box. Okay, in simple words, I can tell you just this. In production limiting programs, producers cannot increase production. Okay, so they can keep that subsidy under blue box if they agree that they will not increase production. What is the rationale? Even blue box subsidies, somehow like green box, okay, I forgot to tell you about the rule. Green box subsidies need not be reduced. Okay, or there is no reduction commitment on green box subsidies. There is no reduction commitment as well as there are no upper limits. A country can give any amount of green box subsidy without reducing. I hope you are following that. Okay. What about blue box? Even blue box subsidies don't need to be reduced, although there is limit. But even blue box subsidies are without reduction commitment. The claim is that because production is not increasing. Okay, leave it. There is a lot of debate. There used to be a lot of debate earlier on blue box, but you are not going to get questions on that in all probability. More debate now is on amber box. How do we define amber box? Exact opposite to the green box. Amber box subsidies are trade distorting subsidies in the eyes of WTO. So if WTO thinks any subsidy is distorting trade, is impacting trade, they put it in the amber box. And we know about some examples already. Within amber box or trade distorting subsidies, they would either talk about input subsidies in agriculture. You are well aware of the input subsidies like fertilizer subsidy, okay, is an amber box subsidy. Apart from input subsidy, they also include production related subsidies. You have idea of production related subsidies also, like MSP in India. Minimum support price is a production related subsidy that is also an amber box subsidy. Now what about rule of amber box? These subsidies need to be reduced, but the rule is not that every country has to reduce it. Okay, there is an important thing here in amber box also. So this is the last thing which we are doing in the domestic subsidy related thing. There is a rule which we call de minimis level. Okay, the concept is fairly simple. Don't get scared by the name much. De minimis level. What is de minimis level in WTO? Let me define it formally. De minimis level has got two parts in its definition. It refers to 5% of agricultural GDP or agricultural production. If we are talking about a developed country, and 10% of agricultural GDP if we are talking about a developing country. You will see that many a times in WTO that the rules are different for developed and developing countries because they are in different stages of their development. Okay. Now what is the logic behind keeping this 5%, 10% here? Okay. The rule says that if amber box subsidy crosses de minimis level, okay, if amber box subsidy is higher than de minimis level, then they need to be reduced. Okay, I repeat, up to de minimis level, no reduction. Okay, it's like if amber box subsidy is given up to de minimis level, no reduction is needed. Reduction will be needed if they are higher than de minimis level. So it's like for every $100 of agricultural GDP, if US gives more than $5 of amber box subsidy, then they need to bring it down. For a country like India, the rule is more relaxed. We can give up to 10% of our agricultural GDP. I hope I'm clear on that. In 1995, all these rules are being decided upon. Okay, and just one last thing here. Developed countries are given 6 years to reduce their subsidy if they are giving beyond de minimis level. So developed countries were given 6 years in 1995 to reduce the subsidy. Developing countries were given 10 years. Okay, so as you can see here also there is a relaxation. Okay, a general term which I would like to use here, not just related to agriculture. It's a general term in WTO. We call it special and differential treatment. So in WTO many a times you will see special and differential treatment. What is special and differential treatment? Special and differential treatment tells that the developing and underdeveloped countries, the developing and underdeveloped countries should be treated in a special and differential manner from developed countries. Okay, the developing and underdeveloped countries should be treated in a special and differential manner as compared to developed countries. In simple words, there should be relaxed rules for developing and underdeveloped countries. Don't you see a couple of examples of S and D treatment we have already done? Okay, the different de minimis level for developed and developing countries and the different, you can say, tenure given to them for reducing subsidies are some examples of S and D. I hope you are following. Which is desirable. Okay, S and D is very much justified because when WTO is formed in 1995, different countries are in different stage of development. You cannot have the same rule for all of them. Some of them are already well developed, some of them are still developing. So that is why S and D makes sense. Not just in agriculture, you will see its reflections in many other parts of WTO. We are done with agreement on agriculture, with this. Okay, let's talk about how India has got impacted by this. And similarly, we'll be looking into the other agreements also. So we now have a discussion on it's like the second half of the same section where we talk of Indian agriculture and WTO. When in 1995 we signed this agreement, we thought we will benefit. Okay, why so? Because we ourselves were giving very low subsidy. India was giving almost zero export subsidy. And even our domestic subsidies were very low. Okay, now we give more domestic subsidy, but when we are signing it in 95, our subsidies were very low. Who were giving most of the subsidies then? Either US or European Union. So it is US and European Union who were the major subsidy providers in 95. So what did we think? We thought that these US, EU, etc. members will reduce the subsidy and that will benefit us. Going back to example of India and Bangladesh, don't you see there? If India decides to reduce subsidy, Bangladesh will hope to benefit. But that didn't happen. Okay, agriculture has been a big disappointment in WTO for India, because that all would have happened had US and European Union would have reduced the subsidy. Actually, they didn't. Okay, let me talk about that in detail. And that is where I'm talking about Doha Ministerial of 2001. Okay, a general remark before I come to agriculture. In WTO, we have ministerial conferences. Ministerial conferences in WTO are very important, which takes place every 2 years. The word ministerial is giving you a hint already. In these ministerial conference, the trade or commerce ministers of a country take part, of the WTO members take part. Okay, so ministerial conferences are where either trade or commerce minister, in India we have commerce minister taking part in WTO meeting. What is so unique about ministerial conference? Ministerial conference in WTO can only take binding decisions. Binding in the sense that they must be followed. Okay, so it's like this. WTO countries may keep on talking about number of issues. That hardly matters unless that issue is approved in ministerial conference. Only when some decision is approved in ministerial conference, it becomes binding in WTO. So keep that in mind. That is why we give a lot of importance to the different ministerial conferences. By now, we have 13 ministerial conferences, okay? So the ministerial conferences which are there, 11 ministerial conferences, which was the last one took place in Argentina, okay? However, all these ministerials are not important. Some of them are more important than the other. So there are some 2-3 ministerials I'll mainly be talking about. One is Doha, okay, Doha ministerial, which was taking place in 2001. And then some of the recent ministerials we'll talk about. Why Doha is so important? Okay, these ministerials are named after the place where the meetings took place. Why Doha ministerial is so important? Because it happens exactly 6 years after 95, if you are noticing. That is the time period given to the developed countries to reduce subsidies. Okay, remember a few minutes ago we were talking about that. Now, what was the status of these countries? US did not reduce even amber box subsidies. US did not reduce amber box subsidies. So in a way, quite openly flouting the agreement. Okay, what about European Union? European Union was more compliant. It reduced amber box subsidies, but increased green box subsidies significantly. Okay, when I say significantly, I mean today European Union is giving more than 10 times, yes, more than 10 times green box subsidy than it was giving in 1995. Okay, so there is actually a process where amber box subsidies have reduced, but green box subsidies have gone up, which is informally called a box shifting mechanism in WTO. This is very informal. European Union will never agree to a term called box shifting. Okay, box shifting is like converting your amber box subsidy to the green box. And you can guess why are they doing it? Because green box subsidies need not be reduced. Okay, now you will say that, okay, for US it is fine. They are flouting the agreement. They should be criticized for it. But why are we blaming European Union? After all, green box doesn't impact trade. That is what WTO believes. But there is a lot of debate on that. Okay, there are many studies, there are many researches done on green box subsidies, which are claiming that even some green box subsidies impact trade. Okay, so very quickly on that. The claim is that some of the green box subsidies actually impacts trade. Impacts trade, impacts production, etc. And one of the examples, common examples of such criticism is decoupled payments. We have done decoupled payments, the payments made to the farmers irrespective of production. But the problem is, in European Union, these decoupled payments are very high. Okay, these decoupled payments are very high. So when we have very, very high decoupled payments given to the farmers, even irrespective of how much they produce, definitely it has been shown that it increases production, it impacts trade. Even thinking logically, if you give a lot of payments to the farmers, okay, irrespective of production also, he is likely to use it for production and exports. There are many empirical studies done on that, which for you don't need to go into detail. But that is what India also claims in WTO, that contrary to your view, green box subsidies are actually trade distorting. And all the more when they are increasing so much. They have increased also in US. Okay. That is why we couldn't benefit in agriculture as we had expected. India would have benefited only if these countries would have reduced the subsidies, but they have actually not. But it seems a little surprising, particularly for US. How can they openly flout WTO agreement? Why can't someone complain about US and WTO and fight a case against them? US has been very clever in its strategy. They never directly say in WTO that they will not reduce embargo subsidy. Never. Okay, US will always keep on saying, we are ready to reduce, given that you follow XYZ conditions. They keep on linking their agricultural subsidy reduction to one or the other thing. At least one concept I would like to talk about in this background, which also comes in Doha ministerial. Although this concept is not very popular one right now in WTO, but still you should be a little aware of it. The concept is called NAMA. If I give you a full form, many of you can define it yourself. NAMA refers to non-agricultural market access. Non-agricultural market access. Market access we have done. Hope you recall. Lower tariff and non-tariff barriers. Here they are talking mainly about lower tariff barriers. Who is talking about when I say they are US? Okay, the NAMA issue has been brought by US in WTO. So here US was demanding lower tariffs on non-agricultural products. So NAMA, I repeat, NAMA is all about the demand by US particularly to reduce tariff on non-agricultural products. Demand from whom? From the developing countries like India. Because actually our non-agricultural tariffs are higher. Non-agriculture means what? Mainly industrial sector. Although strictly speaking, NAMA is not just about industries. Let me tell you that also. It includes industries mainly, but also the sectors like forestry, fishing. Okay, because forestry, fishing, etc., they are not a part of agriculture. So NAMA includes any non-agricultural good. It may be industrial goods mainly, it may be goods related to forestry, fishing sector, etc. Why is US demanding that, first of all? US argument is like this. US is telling a country like India that after all, why do you want less embargo subsidies from US? To benefit your farmers? Think of it. Why would India benefit by lower embargo subsidy of US? Because that will benefit our farmers. If they reduce embargo subsidy, our farmers become more competitive. Getting the point? Okay, hence we benefit. US said in 2001, by the same logic, by NAMA demand, our industrial sector will benefit. So if you can talk about welfare of your farmers, why can't we talk about our industrial sector? Isn't it? We as in US. Seems logical, but actually it is not. How can you compare the living standard of an Indian farmer with the US industrialist? Okay, there is no comparison. Okay, there is no comparison between the industrialists or forestry fishing sector in US and the Indian farmers. Okay, sounds logical, but it is not. Okay, you cannot compare agriculture with your industrial sector. But US knew that this is the only way in which they can postpone their subsidies reduction. So US said in 2001, we are ready to reduce embargo subsidies. But given that developing countries like India reduce their NAMA tariff. In 2001, US said that I'm ready to reduce embargo subsidy. But given that India or other developing countries reduce their NAMA tariff, it knew very well that we will not be able to reduce it that quickly. Hence, it will get more time to give the subsidy. Okay, so this is a clever strategy. And you will see more clever strategies by US in coming part. Okay, I hope I'm clear on this so far. Actually, this debate goes on for almost a decade. This debate between Amber Box subsidies and NAMA is a very prolonged debate in WTO. Starting from 2001, almost for a decade, we have hardly any productive agreement in WTO due to this. Because both developed and developing countries were sticking to their ground. Developing countries like India was telling, we will reduce NAMA tariff only after you reduce your agricultural subsidies. And developed countries the opposite. First you reduce NAMA tariff, then we reduce Amber Box subsidy. Neither of them ready to budge. Okay, the WTO talks are not happening very productively. So that is why I will not be referring to any ministerial for almost a decade. There is nothing productive happening, actually. Let's straight away come to the Bali ministerial in 2013. Okay, 9th ministerial of WTO took place in Bali. Quite important for agriculture. Before I talk about Bali ministerial, one more general note to you. If you read any article on WTO, you will come across two similar sounding terms. Doha ministerial and Doha round. They are not same. Doha ministerial and Doha round are quite different. I just wanted to clarify. Doha ministerial is just an event which took place in 2001, as I discussed. What do we mean by Doha round? Doha round of WTO means the talks which began in 2001, which continue even till date. Doha round of WTO has started in 2001 and still continues. We are not yet finished with Doha round. That is another debate between developed and developing countries. Developed countries are telling, it's too long around, let's finish it. Let's start afresh on WTO talks. That is what developed countries say. Sounds very logical to many of you. But developing countries like India are telling, hold on, first follow your promise of Doha. Okay, follow the promise on Amber Box subsidies, etc. And there are some more promises, which we'll see. Unless those promises are kept, how can Doha round be finished? So Doha round is still continuing. The developing countries like India have another problem in finishing Doha round. They are not aware what new things are going in mind of developed countries. If they finish it, what new things will be coming in? We are not aware. So we are a little suspicious of developed countries, not little, a lot. Okay, given the nature of WTO talks that have gone in the last two decades. Okay. So, all the ministerial that we are discussing are in Doha round, like Bali ministerial, again in Doha round. Okay, all the other ministerials. Okay. Why Bali ministerial is so important? There are two issues which are very important in Bali ministerial. The first one is called food security issue. Okay, food security issue, which is where India is at the center. Okay, before food security issue, telling you what is this, let me talk about a unique demand made by US just before Bali ministerial. Just before Bali ministerial, US demanded India, and this is a specific demand from India, remember. US demanded India to reduce its subsidies on public stock holding of grains. Okay, let me simplify this. Okay, you know about it actually. What is the meaning of public stock holding? Public stock holding means the procurement by government. Okay, whenever government procures grains and keeps its stocks, we call it public stock holding of grains. And what is the subsidy on public stock holding? MSP, very correct. So here US is talking about our MSP policy. US is telling that MSP in India is a subsidy on public stock holding which should reduce. Why? Because MSP is a part of Emberbox. And by agreement on agriculture, Emberbox subsidy should be reduced. Okay, we have done all that. Now, how do we look at this demand? Okay, is this demand sensible or not? Sensible or not, we'll see a little later. First of all, look who is making this demand. Okay, the country which has openly violated WTO rule, at least in agriculture, the country which itself didn't reduce the subsidy, now demanding a country like India to reduce it. And why suddenly this demand comes in 2013 around that? Because of our National Food Security Act. So we had National Food Security Act in 2013. Although when US made this demand, it was only a bill. The act became in 2013. Earlier it was only a National Food Security Bill. You have seen that under National Food Security Act, the coverage is very high. That is what US is telling, that you are covering so many people in your food security. That will mean more and more MSP, higher Emberbox subsidy, which is not ideal in WTO. Okay, in this background comes this food security issue. Let's talk about food security issue now. Food security issue, in simple words, is Indian response to the US demand. So in WTO, if a country has made has blamed you for something, you have to respond. So Indian response here is what we call the food security issue. Indian response had two, three things. Number one, that the subsidy which we are giving is for not distorting trade, but for food security. So point number one, India says that, look, we are giving MSP, but the goal is not to impact trade. The goal is to have food security. That is why the name food security issue. Okay, that is why we call it food security issue, because Indian claim is we are giving these subsidies for food security, not for distorting trade. Second, India says that these subsidies are still lower than de minimis level. These subsidies are still lower than de minimis level. And as you have seen, if it is below de minimis level, we can give the subsidy. Okay, so logically speaking, we can give the subsidy as long as it is not crossing de minimis level. Third, India also says that there are many limitations in subsidy calculation in WTO. Okay, that itself is a wide area of debate, but at least one example I'll give you. What kind of limitations is India talking of? As we have done earlier, that in MSP, subsidy is MSP minus market price. Okay, the subsidy amount is MSP minus market price. Now the problem is that in WTO, this market price which they calculate is the market price of the time period 1986 to 88. Okay, why 1986 to 88? The Uruguay round. Okay, don't forget these agreements are drafted during the Uruguay round. So when in Uruguay round, they were drafting agreement on agriculture, they had taken market price of 1986 to 88. And still now, even till date, they calculate subsidy on that market price, which is clearly a problem. Anyone can see that. Okay, it is clearly a problem because market price of 86 to 88 is very low. So India is telling you are exaggerating our subsidy. Okay, are you getting the point? India is telling since your market prices are very old, okay, you are exaggerating our subsidy. You are comparing MSP of 2011-12 with market price of 86-88. Not done. So change it. Okay, there is another argument made by India. When these subsidies are calculated, they are multiplied with total production. That is one of the current issue also. If you are reading newspapers, you must have read about the claim by US, Europe, that India is understating its subsidy. India is giving wrong